Welcome back to Sunday Night Spookies, the podcast dedicated to exploring the mysterious and the spooky unknown. My name is Lex.
And I'm Sarah.
And this is episode 17, Dybbuk Boxes.
So if any of you are horror movie fans, like I am, you might have seen the 2012 movie called The Possession, and that was inspired by a very specific Dybbuk box that we're going to talk about today. Funnily enough, I've never seen it.
Me either. No.
But now I kind of want to. So you may have heard about Dybbuk boxes because of this movie, but also because of Zak Bagans, if you follow him at all.
If you watch Ghost Adventures or...
Yeah.
Ghost Adventures Artifact.
Don't do it. Don't open one.
Don't.
So we thought it would be a really good idea to dive into the actual history of Dybbuk boxes. What is a Dybbuk? What's a Dybbuk box? And all of that. And why it's bad to open one.
Mm-hmm.
And why Post Malone was cursed.
Yeah.
So to start off, a Dybbuk is a restless, usually malicious spirit believed to be able to haunt or even possess living people. In Jewish folklore, the Dybbuk cannot leave the body until it's exorcised or until it's accomplished its goal. I guess in some cases, the Dybbuk will actually have like a specific purpose and specific goal that it's trying to accomplish. And if it accomplishes that, it can leave the body. A disembodied human spirit, because of former sins or its restlessness, if it's wandering, like if the soul, almost like kind of like limbo is what I would equate it to. If it's in limbo, the Dybbuk can find that soul, attach itself to the soul, and then guide that soul to possess another human. So kind of a back-asswards way of possession. Belief in such spirits like this was very popular in the 16th and 17th century. We've read a lot in some articles that the Dybbuk is equated to like the witches, the Salem witch trials for Christians. It was also believed to be the cause or root behind a lot of mental illness, as it was in Christian beliefs as well.
Because like they couldn't explain mental illnesses, so they had to...
When mental health wasn't a thing.
Right. They had to tack it to something.
Yeah, it was the devil's in ya.
Yeah.
That's why you're sick. Devil's in ya. So, as you can imagine, the Dybbuk usually comes from a domain of evil, or in the Kabbalistic terminology. There's a lot of Jewish and Hebrew words in here, and we're sorry if we mispronounce them. We're going to try our best. So in the Kabbalistic terminology, the Sitra Ara, or the other side, is an inversion of the divine world and the abode of dark forces. So kind of like a heaven and hell, if... I mean, that's what I think most people can equate that to if you don't know anything about Jewish religion. The demon would then, like I said, guide the renegade soul to another body to possess it. This not only gave the kind of wandering soul spirit refuge in another human, but it also gave the Dybbuk an opportunity to take control of the possessed person's body to do its dirty bidding. So most frequently, the unfortunate person who was possessed by the Dybbuk was a woman, and it's usually represented as the Dybbuk being male, penetrating the body of the woman. This represented both, obviously, a sexual aspect, but an illustration of the doctrine of opposites, male and female, living and dead, pure and impure, all fused together in the human body. So kind of like that dualistic nature. Exercising a Dybbuk, or the removing of the destructive forces from a pure soul, is not just very important to save the life of the person who's been possessed, but it's kind of been referred to as a battle in a cosmic war, which sounds pretty freaking intense. I don't know much about like Jewish religion other than what I've learned through, you know, this research, but that sounds really intense. That's like such a strong sentence to use. It just makes me very curious.
Right.
Very curious. So Jewish women believed to be possessed by Dybbuks, like I said earlier, would have been condemned just as witches were in the Christian views. So not a very good thing to be.
Which I think is interesting, because if you're possessed by a Dybbuk, you didn't choose it. Whereas, like, if you practice witchcraft, that's, like, a choice.
Yeah, it was like you made a deal with the devil and you're practicing black magic.
Right.
I've read that in my research that you can do things to bring on the possession of a Dybbuk. Like, not, like, well, and that? it wasn't, I don't think it was necessary. I mean, I'm sure that you could, but the stuff that I was reading was more like if you...
Your actions would make you more susceptible
like to if the possession of. If you didn't...
Sure.
Fully believe that Moses crossed the Red Sea. That was when I saw a lot, that if you didn't believe or had any kind of doubt that did Moses really cross the Red Sea, that would immediately open you up to a Dybbuk possession, supposedly. Better be strong in your faith. As we said before, exercising a Dybbuk is very, very involved. Don't try this at home. Thank you.
No.
Leave it to the professionals. This involved removing it from the body, obviously, and returning it to the world of the dead. This way, a small piece of cosmic order is said to be restored, and the Dybbuk, of course, didn't want to go.
No.
Like, all possessing things. They don't want to leave their host.
No, not without a fight.
No. So, this would then ensue a very dramatic and terrifying ritual to force this reluctant Dybbuk out of the body, and the ceremony was conducted in a synagogue in the presence of 10 men who had purified themselves through fasting and ritual immersion. They would all dress in the white shrouds like a corpse would be buried in. Like, have you ever seen like medieval art or like any medieval depictions of corpses? They would always be bound in white cloth. They would also be wreathed in prayer shawls, their heads and arms bound with the sacred parchments worn in daily prayer. The exorcist would then address the Dybbuk directly, listing the offenses that the soul had committed during its human life, which might include apostasy, talebearing or gossip, suicide, murder, or ritually deviant conduct behavior. The exorcist would both cajole and threaten the Dybbuk to get it to leave, with the Dybbuk then fully cognizant of the trouble it was in for taking over an innocent person. The ark in the synagogue would then be opened, which contained the 7 scrolls of Torah. The 7 scrolls were then removed. 7 blasts are blown on 7 ram's horns, and 7 black candles are lit. Curses were then proclaimed, incantations recited, and 7 different combinations of the 42-letter name of God pronounced. And that's what's going to be the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
If it was all successful, the Dybbuk is then exorcised. It was very important that the exorcist remained strong-hearted and displayed no fear, just like Christian-based exorcisms. It was very imperative that they say strong-hearted, no fear. The spirit was to leave the body only between the big toe and its toenail, which makes you cringe.
Like cringe, yeah, every time you say that.
Well, I thought that was very interesting because the little knowledge that I know about exorcisms, I've never heard of them having a specific exit point on the body. So I thought that was like a very interesting specific fact about the exorcism of a Dybbuk itself. And it said that any other exit route might cause permanent damage to the actual person that it was that the Dybbuk possessed. Crucially, the spirit was supposed to be warned with threats or curses that it was never to enter anybody else. And there was no place for the world of the dead in the abode of the living. Basically, you don't live here. You're supposed to be basically in a hell or the other side.
That's where you go.
Get on.
Skedaddle.
Get on. So now you might be wondering, where the heck does the box come in? What's a Dybbuk box?
So there's actually 10 Dybbuk boxes, but first we're going to talk about just one, which is the Dybbuk box.
Mm-hmm. The one that kind of started the interest
right.
in all it's of this stuff.
The most famous of the Dybbuk boxes. And that Dybbuk box is a vintage wine cabinet that is said, obviously, to house a Dybbuk. It's said that all of the evil from the 20th century, like World War II, the Korean War, Khmer Rouge, and even more, are contained inside of the 10 Dybbuk boxes, and that by opening any one of the boxes will summon all of the evil back into the world.
So someone opened one for 2020.
Yeah. Honestly. So a man named Kevin Manis is the owner that kind of brought the Dybbuk box to the forefront. Kind of made it, I don't want to say popular because that sounds positive.
Yeah.
But
it's not positive.
No. But he kind of made people interested in it. Kevin Manis had a really negative experience with the Dybbuk box, which prompted him to sell it. And I actually have the original listing on eBay for when he was selling it. And it's kind of long, so I apologize for that. But it really gets into the history, the experiences.
It goes into such great detail. Like she said, it's long, but I think it's really important to hear the whole thing to get a better idea of all of it.
And I would be talking for this long even if I wasn't reading directly from my screen anyway. So this is written by Kevin Manis, and this was his listing on the eBay auction for the Dybbuk box. And the listing reads as follows. All of the events that I'm about to set forth in this listing are accurate and may be verified by the winning bidder with the copies of hospital records and sworn affidavits that I'm including as part of the sale of the cabinet. During September of 2001, I attended an estate sale in Portland, Oregon. The items liquidated at this sale were from the estate of a woman who had passed away at the age of 103. A granddaughter of the woman told me that the grandmother had been born in Poland, where she grew up, married, raised a family, and lived until she was sent to a Nazi concentration camp during World War II. She was the only member of her family who survived the camp. Her parents, brothers, a sister, husband, and two sons and a daughter were all killed. She survived the camp by escaping with some other prisoners and somehow making her way to Spain, where she lived until the end of the war. I was told that she acquired the small wine cabinet listed here in Spain, and it was one of only three items that she brought with her when she immigrated to the United States. The other two items were a steamer trunk and a sewing box. I purchased this wine cabinet along with the sewing box and some other furniture at the estate sale. After the sale, I was approached by the woman's granddaughter who said, "I see you got the Dybbuk box." She was referring to the wine cabinet. I asked her what a Dybbuk box was, and she told me that when she was growing up, her grandmother always kept the wine cabinet in her sewing room. It was always shut and set in a place that was out of reach. The grandmother always called it a Dybbuk box. When the girl asked her grandmother what was inside, her grandmother spit three times through her fingers and said, "A Dybbuk and Kesselim." The grandmother went on to tell the girl that the wine cabinet was never, ever to be opened. The granddaughter told me that her grandmother had asked that the box be buried with her. However, as such a request was contrary to the rules of an Orthodox Jewish burial, the grandmother's request had not been honored. I asked the granddaughter what a Dybbuk and Kesselim were, but she did not know. I asked her if she would like me to open it. She did not want to open it, as her grandmother had been very emphatic and serious when she instructed her not to do so. And regardless of the reason, she wanted to honor her grandmother's request. I finally ended up offering to let her keep what seemed to me to be a sentimental keepsake. At that point, she was very insistent and said, "No, no, you bought it." I explained that I didn't want my money back and that it would make me feel better to do what I thought was an act of kindness. She then became somewhat upset. Looking back now, the way that she became upset was just plain odd. She raised her voice to me and said, "You bought it, you made a deal." When I tried to speak, she yelled, "We don't want it." She began to cry, asked me to leave, and quickly walked away. I wrote the whole episode off to the stress and grief she must have been experiencing. I took my purchases and politely left. At the time when I bought the cabinet, I owned a small furniture refinishing business. I took the cabinet to my store and put it in my basement workshop, where I intended to refinish it and give it as a gift to my mother. I didn't think anything more about it. I opened my shop for the day and went to run errands, leaving the young woman who did sales for me in charge. After about a half hour, I got a call on my cell phone. The call was from my salesperson. She was absolutely hysterical and screaming that someone was in my workshop, breaking glass and swearing. Furthermore, the intruder had locked the iron security gates and the emergency exit and she couldn't get out. As I told her to call the police, my cell phone battery went dead. I hit speeds of 100 miles per hour getting back to the shop. When I arrived, I found the gates locked. I went inside and found my employee on the floor in the corner of my office sobbing hysterically. I ran to the basement and went down the stairs. At the bottom of the stairs, I was hit by an overpowering, unmistakable odor of cat urine, and there had never been any animals kept or found in my shop. The lights didn't work. As I investigated, I found that the reason the lights didn't work also explained the sounds of glass breaking. All of the light bulbs in the basement were broken. All 9 incandescent bulbs had been broken in their sockets, and 10 4-foot fluorescent tubes were lying shattered on the floor. I did not find an intruder, however. I should also add that there was only one entrance to the basement. It would have been impossible for anyone to leave without meeting me head-on. I went back to speak with my salesperson, but she had left. She never returned to work after having been with me for 2 years. She refuses to discuss the incident to this day. I never thought of relating the events of that day to anything having to do with the cabinet. But then things got worse. As I already indicated, I have decided to give the cabinet to my mother as a birthday gift. About 2 weeks after I made the purchase, I decided to get started refinishing it. I was surprised to find that the cabinet has a unique little mechanism. When you open one of the doors, the mechanism causes the opposite door and the little drawer below to open at the same time. It is very well made. Inside the cabinet, I found the following items. 1 1928 U.S. wheat penny. 1 1925 U.S. wheat penny. 1 small lock of blonde hair bound with string. 1 small lock of black or brown hair bound with a string. 1 small granite statue engraved and gilded with Hebrew letters. I've been told that the letters spelled out the word shalom. 1 dried rosebud, 1 golden wine cup, 1 very strange black cast iron candlestick holder with octopus legs. I saved all of the items in the box intending to return them to the estate. The family has refused the item, so they will be included in the sale of this cabinet. After opening the cabinet, I decided not to refinish it. I cleaned it and rubbed it in some lemon oil. It was at this time that I had noticed that there was an inscription in Hebrew carved into the back of the cabinet. I have no idea what it says or if it's significant. I've included a picture of that inscription below. On my mother's birthday, October 28th, 2001, my mother called me to tell me that she was going out of town with my sister for 3 days, and we postponed celebrating her birthday together until she returned. On October 31st, 2001, my mother came to my shop. We were going to have lunch together, but before we were going to leave, I gave her the wine cabinet. She seemed to like it. While she examined it, I went to make a phone call. I hadn't been out of sight more than 5 minutes when one of the employees came running into my office, saying that something was wrong with my mom. When I went back to see what the matter was, I found my mom sitting in a chair beside the cabinet. Her face had no expression, but tears were streaming down her cheeks. No matter how hard I tried to get her to respond, she would not. She could not. It turns out that my mother suffered a stroke. She was taken to the hospital by ambulance. She ended up suffering partial paralysis and losing her ability to speak and form words. She has since regained the ability to speak. She could understand things being said to her and could respond by pointing to letters of the alphabet to spell out words she wanted to say. When I asked her the following day how she was doing, she teared up and spelled out the words, "No gift." I assured her that I had given her a gift for her birthday, thinking that she didn't remember, but she became even more upset and spelled out the words, "Hate gift." I laughed and told her not to worry. I told her I was sorry she didn't like the cabinet and that I would get her anything she wanted if she would promise to get well soon. Still, I didn't associate anything that happened with the cabinet itself or anything paranormal. Frankly, I don't think I ever even used the term paranormal until this last month. I'll try to make this short now. I gave the cabinet to my sister. She kept it for a week and then gave it back. She complained that she could not get the doors to stay closed and that they kept coming open. There are no springs in the door mechanism, and I have never found that the doors came open. I gave it to my brother and his wife, who kept it for 3 days and then gave it back. My brother said that it smelled like jasmine flowers, while his wife insisted that it put out the odor of cat urine. I gave it to my girlfriend, who asked me to sell it for her after only 2 days. I sold it the same day to a nice middle-aged couple. 3 days later, when I came to open the shop for the day, I found the cabinet sitting at the front doors with a note that read, "This has such a bad darkness." I had no idea what that meant. Anyway, I ended up taking it home. Then, things got even worse. Since the day I brought it home, I began having a strange recurring nightmare. Every time I have the horrible dream, it goes something like this. I find myself walking with a friend, usually someone I know well and trust, at some point in the dream. I find myself looking into the eyes of the person that I'm with. It's then that I realize that there is something different, something evil looking back at me. At that point in my dream, the person I'm with changes into what can only be described as the most gruesome, demonic-looking hag that I've ever seen. This hag proceeds then to beat the living tar out of me. I have awakened numerous times to find bruises and marks on myself where I had been hit by the old woman during the previous night. Still, I never related the nightmares to the cabinet, nor do I think that I ever would have. About a month ago, however, my sister and my brother and his wife came over to my house and spent the night. The following morning during breakfast, my sister complained that she had had a horrible nightmare. She said that she recalled having it a couple days before and went on to describe my nightmare exactly to the last detail. My brother and his wife froze as they listened, and then chimed in that they both had had the exact same dreams during the night as well. The hair was standing up on the back of my neck, and it still is. As we talked, it became clear that the common denominator was that each of us had had the nightmare during the times that the cabinet was in our respective homes. I called my girlfriend and asked if she could recall having any nightmares recently. She described the same nightmare, same hag, everything. When I asked her if she remembered the date when she had the nightmare, she said she did not. Then I asked if it happened to be the night before she gave me the cabinet back to sell for her. She said, "Yeah, hey, how did you know that?" Now, since my family discussion, it seems like all hell is breaking loose. For a week afterward, I started seeing what I can only describe as shadowy things in my peripheral vision. In fact, numerous visitors to my house have claimed that they've seen the same shadow things. I put the cabinet in an outside storage unit and was awakened when the smoke alarm in the unit went off in the middle of the night. When I went to see what was burning, I opened the door and didn't see any smoke. However, I did get hit with the smell of cat urine. When I went back inside, the smell was there in my house, too. I do not own a cat and I never have. I went back outside and grabbed the cabinet. I brought it back inside and tried to research it on the internet. While I was surfing the net, I fell asleep and once again had the same nightmare. I woke up at around 4:30 a.m. when it felt and smelled like something was breathing on my neck, to find that my house now smelled like jasmine flowers, and just in time to see a huge shadow thing go loping down the hallway away from me. I would destroy this thing in a second, except I don't really have any understanding of what I may or may not be dealing with. I am afraid, and I do mean afraid, that if I destroy the cabinet, whatever it is that seems to have come with the cabinet may just stay here with me. I've been told that there are people who shop on eBay that understand these kinds of things and specifically look for these kinds of items. If you are one of these people, please, please buy this cabinet and do whatever you will do with a thing like this. Help me. You can see that I have no reserve price or minimum bid. If I can make things any easier, let me know and I will do everything within my abilities. One more note. On the same day my mom had her stroke, the lease to my store was summarily terminated without cause. The measurements are 12.5 inches by 7.5 inches by 16.25 inches. All of the items that I originally found inside the cabinet are included in the sale and will be delivered with the cabinet. So after he posted this online, he had to add the following information. There is no way that I can respond to all of the emails I've received since putting this thing online. I'll try now to update and answer the most common questions I've been receiving. 1. No, I am not religious. 2. No, I do not wish to have or participate in any sort of exorcism, or case study, or photo sessions at my home. 3. No, I will not sell any of the individual pieces which were originally found separate from the other pieces in the cabinet. 4. No, I do not speak Hebrew, nor do I know what the word keselim means. I don't know that the word is even a Hebrew word. 5. At the end of the auction, I have decided to take an opportunity to speak with the winning bidder for two reasons. A. To make sure that the winning bidder is a serious adult who has employed some valid reasoning skills in making the decision to accept whatever this is. I will not be judgmental. Do whatever you want or need after the sale. B. To offer full details of the events that have transpired. After I've carried out those responsibilities and upon payment, I will have the cabinet and its contents delivered by U.S. mail, FedEx, or UPS to the winning bidder. At that point, I will have no further involvement with the matter in any way, shape, or form, period. And 6, to all of you who have offered to pray, I may not be religious, but I am certainly open to the possibilities, no matter what your religion might be. Thank you. Here's another update for everyone following this listing. No. No, I will not circumvent or make any deals outside of eBay, even for more money than the final auction price. If you want to win the auction and have the kind of money some of you are offering, there shouldn't be any reason why you cannot simply place your bid in an open, honest fashion. I'm sure you can understand why this might be suspicious. Also, for those of you wanting to know if I'm still experiencing anything out of the ordinary, I thought everything was going okay until I got home on Friday, the 13th of June, and found that the fish in my freshwater aquarium, all 10, were dead. I'm still hoping that all of this is coincidental crap.
I don't know if it's all coincidental, man.
Not feeling very coincidental is all that I'm saying.
No, not at all.
Another one of the owners was a student at Truman State University in Kirksville, Missouri, and he was the last person to auction the box on eBay. He claimed that the box caused lights to burn out in his house, so that's similar, except for they weren't smashed out, I guess. And it also caused his hair to fall out.
Oh. Sorry about your baldness, bud.
This student was writing blogs about his experiences, and he documented that he was more than ready to be rid of the box. And so he sold it on eBay to a man named Jason Haxton, who was the director of the Museum of Osteopathic Medicine in Kirksville, Missouri. Haxton wrote a book called The Dybbuk Box and claimed that he had subsequently developed strange health problems, including hives, coughing up blood, and head-to-toe welts.
Coughing up blood?
That's, yeah.
Oof.
Haxton also consulted with rabbis, or if you don't know what a rabbi is, it's a Jewish religious leader. I think that's probably pretty common knowledge, but in case you don't know, he consulted with rabbis to try to figure out a way to seal the Dybbuk in the box again. Apparently successful, he took the freshly sealed box and hid it at a secret location, which he refused to reveal. Mm-hmm. And then he later donated the box to Zak Bagans.
Yes.
Of Ghost Adventures. If you don't know who Zak Bagans is, who are you? And why are you listening?
Like, I feel like he's like...
Don't mean to come on that strong, but like, here's, love him or hate him, you should know who he is.
He's a whack job.
He is a lot. So, the Ghost Adventures star, Zak Bagans, paranormal investigator, he acquired the box, and it's now in his Las Vegas Haunted Museum, which we still have to go to. It's fine.
Yeah, we have to go to it.
And shortly after its arrival, mysterious protruding holes began to appear in the walls around the artifact as if something was trying to break out from within the exhibit. Mm-mm.
No, I'm... That's game for me, bro. I'm done.
Right? Since it's been on display, Bagans and museum staff and visitors have experienced black shadows, fainting, feelings of sickness, anger, anxiety, and more. I don't know if we're even supposed to, like, talk about other shows. Yeah. I don't know if that's allowed. But you know what? Here's a little free publicity. Watch the episode in which Zak Bagans opens the Dybbuk
box. So dumb.
I think that's...
Like, I get it, right? You're curious, because I'm flipping curious,
better
too.
Him than me is all I'm saying.
But...
yeah, it's... I would never.
No.
I would never. But it's a really great episode. It's... I think it's like 45 minutes long, but it's definitely worth it.
Is that the same episode, or Post Malone is there as well, or is that separate?
I want to say that it's the same one. Don't quote me, though.
Mm. Because he got cursed from this specific Dybbuk box. Mm-hmm. Or so he says. Grain of salt, but right. You know.
Yeah. After Post Malone was with Zak Bagans and touched the Dybbuk box for the first time, Post Malone thinks that he was cursed because his plane's tires blew out, his Rolls Royce was in a car accident, and his former house was robbed. So that's a lot of negatives.
That's a lot of coincidence to happen.
I don't believe in coincidences.
Right after.
I said it once, I'll say it a million times. Don't believe in them.
You don't believe in coincidences?
No. No, I just won't. It's not real.
Maybe we should do an episode about the conspiracy of coincidences.
And probability.
Yeah.
Yeah. So as I said before, there's actually 10 Dybbuk boxes, which in of itself is terrifying to think that there are 10 individual boxes out there with demonic spirits possessing them and waiting to be opened and released into the world.
Especially if you don't know. Like, what if I go to an estate sale? I'm like, wow, this is a pretty cool cabinet.
And you're like, this is fun.
I would absolutely buy it. If it's weird looking, I'm going to buy it.
Right. So I'm going to be honest. I don't really know a lot about the Tree of Life.
There's not really a lot of information out there about it.
Well, there's like the Tree of Life.
But yeah.
Then there's like the Jewish mysticism Tree of Life.
Yeah.
Which is different than...
The Tree of Life.
The Tree of Life that we know or are accustomed to. But each one of the 10 Dybbuk boxes aligns with a branch of the Tree of Life.
Okay.
And so Zak Bagans has two of those. He has the one that's at the root of the Tree of Life, and he has the one that's at the top of the Tree of Life, which is interesting. Not, I don't know the symbolism behind that, but it's interesting that he would have those two.
Yeah, the top and the bottom.
Opposed to like two random ones in the middle.
Yeah.
He's got the one at the root and at the tip of the tree. Just interesting coincidence.
Zak Bagans.
So 8 of the 10 boxes are accounted for. Zak Bagans has two. There's two that
eight are accounted for, you know?
At least we know that. But there are two that are not accounted for and we don't know where they are. And who knows if the person who has them knows
what they are.
Who knows? They might not even know.
Probably not.
You can go on eBay and type in Dybbuk box and try to buy one. I would suggest not doing that because I think you would be wasting your money.
Yeah. Well, and like a Dybbuk box, it doesn't have to be specifically only these 10 wine cabinets.
Right.
Which I think is important to note. You can, not you specifically.
Right.
A rabbi.
A person could.
Yeah. A rabbi or the, you know, a trained personnel can bind these Dybbuks to different containers.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be a wine cabinet. It could be a shoebox for all we know. So you can go on eBay and, or, you know, any weird site and
the dark web, whatever.
Yeah. And try to buy Dybbuk boxes or things that are marketed as Dybbuk boxes. But just,
I would just say err on the side of caution.
Don't.
And just don't. Because
don't do it.
One of two things will happen. You will spend a lot of money and you will have a useless box.
Or
two, you will spend a lot of money
and your life will be fucking hell.
And, in literally regret every decision that you've ever made.
It's kind of like buying a haunted doll. Like, I've considered.
I want to.
Right. It'd be so cool for us as a podcast to have, like, a show haunted doll. However, I want to keep it in my house. Like, where am I going to keep that?
You know where you keep that? You keep it in an apartment. Because then when you move, you just leave it there.
You just is that wrong? So we're going to get one, and you're going to leave it in the apartment.
That's fine. I would have a haunted doll.
But you're either going to pay a lot of money for this haunted doll or Dybbuk box and get nothing.
Or you're going to get...
You're going to get
exactly what you thought you were going to get, and that's a problem.
Right. I mean, like, because there's a YouTube channel that I watch that they have a haunted doll, and it's like, it's a little girl named Shelly, and she's supposed to be really nice, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, right.
But the chance... Like... The chances of you getting a demon and like or something similar, whatever, you know, all of this is a grain of salt, but I don't know if I want to risk that.
It's
my life is hard enough.
Yep. So if you guys have any ideas of where these lost Dybbuk boxes could be, let us know.
Maybe your weird aunt has a wacko wine cabinet that she never lets you open, and she's very like, don't go near the wine cabinet.
If you have a Dybbuk box, I would like to know.
Yeah. Have you bought one? Let me see it.
Right. Or have you tried to buy a Dybbuk box?
Well, not have you tried buying any haunted item?
Yeah. We want to know.
I'm curious. Because if you have, hit us up maybe.
Yeah.
I want to talk to it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't care what it is. I'll talk to it. It's a shoe. I'll talk to it. If you say it's haunted, like, chances are I'm going to try to talk to it.
Yeah, so let us know on any of our social media sites. We are on Instagram at Sunday Night Spookies, on Twitter at Sunday Spookies, and on Facebook at the Sunday Night Spookies Podcast.
So we have a few links in our description box. The first couple you're going to see is our affiliate links. We talk about it in every episode. Affiliate links are products and services that we link to you. We give you a specific code, and we get a small kickback of the products or services you purchase from those specific links. All of these products and services are available without our link and without giving us money. It's just a nice little thing to do if you want to. We have our Instacart link. And if you don't know about Instacart, what are you doing? I use Instacart.
It's a pandemic.
I love Instacart. Even I use Instacart when there's not a pandemic going on. I hate grocery shopping. I hate people. Well, apart from going to the Asian store, I go to the Asian store to get my pork buns and gyoza. Yes. But I love Instacart. You can get your groceries delivered. And if you use our link, you can get free delivery on an order 35 or above. They've also added places like Bed Bath & Beyond and Sephora, I think. So, like, you can just shop now, which I think is really cool.
Yep.
We also have a few affiliate links for some stuff in our Amazon. So our spirit box and our EMF detector are two things we use on absolutely every single investigation. We love those pieces of equipment, and you can purchase them through us, through Amazon if you'd like to. We also have a Buzzsprout link. Buzzsprout is the hosting website that we use for all of our podcasting needs. It's an amazing website. It keeps track of everything we need it to keep track of. Very simple interface to use. It's awesome. So if you're interested in starting your own podcast, please use our link. That's going to be awesome. We also have a support the show link in the show notes, and that just basically goes to our Cash App, or you can make a donation if you'd like to. We are two broke college girls.
Oh yes.
And running a podcast can be kind of expensive with keeping equipment up to date, especially for the some really exciting things that we have happening in 2021. We love it, and we're gonna do it, and we're so excited for these things to happen. Being able to pay for them and keep the quality and, you know, the output great for you guys can be a little bit of a struggle sometimes. So if you're feeling humble, again, we don't expect anything. We just love that you guys listen to this podcast.
And a couple of new things, not a couple of things, one new thing.
Yeah.
It's one new thing. If you have been on any of our social medias lately, as you should be.
Yeah.
You might notice that our bios look a little bit different. So before, there was a link directly to our Buzzsprout so that you could listen, or you could click the Buzzsprout link and go to whatever platform you like to listen on. But now it's a Linktree link.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little bit different. It's got our picture on it. It's legitimate. But that link will house all of our links.
Mm-hmm. It's the link house for all the links.
Right. So there'll be a link to support the show, to listen. There's a link for future exclusive content on Patreon.
Mm-hmm. Stay tuned for that, guys. We're really excited for it.
Yes. And a link to all of our social medias. Maybe more links to come. We're not really sure yet, but it's legitimate. It's just one extra step, but it keeps everything in one spot for you and for us.
And it's important to note that the support the show link on Linktree is the same link in the show notes.
Yep. Yep. It's all the same, just a little bit more organized, I think. When you click the Linktree link, there will be a little banner at the bottom that is asking for donations against racism and in support of justice and equality. You absolutely do not need to donate, but obviously, if you want to donate to the cause against racism or you want to educate yourself, then
more power to you.
Then by all means, click the link and do that. We hope you enjoyed this episode of Sunday Night Spookies.
Join us next week for our episode all about paranormal games. We're going to be attempting some paranormal games and then giving our thoughts about them. So tune in for that next week. I think it's going to be crazy.
Mm-hmm. New episodes are released every Sunday evening. Thanks so much for listening. And as always,
stay spooky. Table bearing or gossip.
Table bearing.
What did I say?
Table bearing.
If you're bearing some tables.
I'm with table.